There we are. Good evening, everybody. We've got a lot of our attendees here. There's going to be some still coming, I'm sure, but in the meantime, we're going to go ahead and get started. Welcome to our Benedictine Conversations, which we're really grateful to be able to do during this time of COVID. There's a lot of us who can't come together in groups. And typically we've had a Benedictine Days event where we bring people into the monastery, which our guest this evening has been to one of those, the first one we had, in fact. But now we can't do those. And so we've been trying to figure out through these past 8-9 months how to connect with you all. And this is working really well. We're really glad you're here. I just want to give you a brief idea of what the format for the evening is. We're going to go through, we're going to start with an opening prayer. And then we're going to have a little bit of conversation between myself and our guest. And then we're going to have a time at the end where you can submit comments, submit questions. If at any time during the time that we are conversing toward the beginning part of it, if you have a question, if you'd submit it by chat, you should also, which is down at the bottom of your screen, you should also have a raise hand function there, which later on, if you want to speak your question or comment, I will be able to unmute you or ask you to unmute yourself, and you'd be able to speak. So anyway, here we are this evening with our wonderful guest that I'm so excited we have here with us during this time of Advent. And his name is Abbot John Klassen. He is a Benedictine. He has entitled our evening in a very interesting way that we'll unpack in a couple of minutes. Hope is not prognostication, a hope rooted in Benedictine practices. Many of you out there are know Abbot John, know of Abbot John, and we have a wonderful bio of him on our website. I'm not going to go and read that all to you. But what I would say to you is he's been the abbot of St. John's Abbey in Collegeville, Minnesota. This is his 21st year, correct? Yes, yes. And he came in as abbot in the last couple of years when I was working on my master's degree myself there at St. John's. And so through these 21 years, I've come to know him as a this wonderful person of talent and integrity and vision. And through these 21 years, he has also served notably as a wise and compassionate leader for the community, the college, the School of Theology. He's a gifted pastor and preacher, wonderful preacher. One of my favorite things about Abbot John is what I would say is that he's a man of the people. When you sit down and have a conversation with Abbot John, it's like sitting and having a cup of coffee with a wise neighbor that you value. So we're just so glad to have you here, Abbot John. I know you've had busy days, and we're just really glad to have this opportunity.
Dawn, thank you so much for your kind introduction. Thank you.
Yes. And here we are in the second week of Advent, Thursday of the second week of Advent, with all our wonderful readings during this season. And I would like you to invite you to start us off with an opening prayer, if you
surely will. Thank you, Don. Thank you so much. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, your heart beats through the universe, giving it life, energy, and hope. Sustain us when we are unsure bewildered, sluggish, or afraid. Strengthen us to always trust that you are with us, guiding us into the future through the Word made flesh and your Holy Spirit of hope. This we ask through the one who is to come, in union with Creator and Spirit, God. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Abbot John, for that beautiful prayer. I'd like to do Lectio Divina on that prayer, but we have another agenda here. I want to start out just by asking you, you know, the people, they love to get to know our guests, and I'd like to start out with asking you, what drew you to the Benedictine life? What draws you to the Benedictine life? If you could speak to that a little bit.
Sure. For me, it really was coming from my own rural area, about 44 miles away, El Rosa, Minnesota, coming to St. John's and being here, really discovering the power of community. On the one hand, knowing and seeing individuals, myself, others, with many, many talents, but seeing really firsthand in community what could happen to those gifts in each other's presence, and the way they're amplified, and the way that they're balanced and complemented by the gifts of the Holy Spirit in the community. I also just was, I came here, of course, to this campus in the 1960s. I was in college in 67 to 71. And a lot of questioning, a lot of changes. I just discovered monks who were, they weren't afraid of questions. They weren't afraid of probing open-endedly. They said simply, I've tried to understand it in the years past and since, and it's the ability and the willingness to live with more questions than answers. And that may seem like a trivial thing. It's not, okay? Because it doesn't mean that you're just, that you have no foundation and that you're just flopping around in a breeze. It means that you're on a foundation, but it's you're standing in the tradition, grounded well enough that you can in fact be open to the future and be open to the real questions that people have, and face them squarely, and be able to move into them. And that's a really important quality, I think, and it's something that attracted me.
That's amazing that you picked up on that and could intuit it and maybe even verbalize it at such a young age. What was it that enabled you to do that?
Oh, you know, but part of that, I think, is the nature of these Benedictine institutions that rely on strong community, and just a place where you can really explore and push and bring in other perspectives and roll ideas around and see how they work. That's what gets you to that point, I think. And that's the, you know, I suspect this was true in a lot of places, but it was certainly true at St. John's when I was a college student here.
Yeah. Well, and I've heard other people speak about it in the same way. And during my time in graduate school there, you know, it I felt it too. Yeah.
Sure. Yeah.
And St. John's, the Abbey and Benedictines were on the cutting edge with a lot of stuff happening at that point. So it was such an exciting time, I'm sure, too.
a lot of ferment going on, a lot of experimentation,
yeah,
and willingness to try things.
Yeah. So, you studied as an undergrad. You studied chemistry. Is that correct?
I did indeed. Yes.
You studied chemistry. So, going on the premise, you know, that each of us has inner attractions, that we are, you know, we feel pulled to certain subjects and so forth. What was it, what attracts you about the field of chemistry?
Science. So, so I really fell in love with chemistry when I was a high school student, a prep kid here on campus. And I was, to this Stearns County farm boy, it was a new world.
Wow.
It was just a totally new world, a world that I had no idea existed.
Huh.
So the way the pieces fit together, but at the same time, no matter how far you go with questions, you never get done. You just keep going, huh? And more and more deep. So it's been a very happy, happy choice.
Yeah. Is there a connection for you with your study of chemistry and your being a monk?
There is, in the sense that, so I had studied chemistry when I came to the monastery, studied theology, fell in love, head over heels in love with scripture, especially Old Testament. And I knew I wanted to study. There was no question about that. I knew I wanted to do advanced work, but didn't. I was torn between chemistry and or scripture. I went to talk to Bill Skidlarek, William.
Yeah.
And I said, what should I do? And he said, do you love chemistry? Do you love it? If you do, and you would like to go into that direction, do so. Because we'll surely have more monks coming along who want to do scripture than chemistry. It was brilliant advice.
It was
the right thing.
Wow.
And of course, scripture and Old Testament, it became the avocation. That's what always happens.
Okay. Yeah.
So.
You know, a couple of things are sitting with me. That word in your opening prayer, sluggishness. Right? Sluggishness, which a lot of us are experiencing right now. And then when you were speaking about what happened to you when you were first at St. John's, this idea of being in community and knowing right where you were, I feel like they tie into the concept of hope. Mm-hmm. Right? And so what I'd like to move to is for us to unpack your title a little bit. Hope. Hope is not a prognostication. And just a disclaimer to all the attendees out there, I've already confessed to the abbot that when he first sent me the title and said, what do you think about this? I thought, I better look this word up before I give any kind of answer. So if you would just speak to that first part for a little bit. Hope is not prognostication.
Yeah, it's Vaclav Havel, and hope is not, good substitution is hope is not, you know, standing where we are in this set of circumstances with a given field of assumptions and predicting the way it's going to go for the future. So at the end of this year here, you'll hear all kinds of prognosticators responding precisely to the question of what do you think 2021 will bring us?
Yeah.
So it's that sense. And that's what Havel is saying. Whatever hope is, it's not that.
So it's not wishful thinking or fervent thinking.
As if we can stand right where we are, mm-hmm. and we can, if we really have hope, we can predict.
We can make it happen. Yeah.
And we can kind of think our way mm-hmm. through it. Huh? Mm-hmm. And he's just saying, no, sit down until the idea goes away.
Okay, so what is it then? So what is hope?
I want to put in a few more denials, okay?
Okay.
Can I do some via negativa?
Sure.
Do some negative way here. So hope is also not a strategy.
Oh.
Is this going to happen? Well, I hope so. Well, if we really want something to happen, where we have some control over it, then we have to, I mean, on the one hand, hope is absolutely essential for anything mm-hmm. to move forward into the future. But we also have to bring some sweat equity and some brain equity to what we're doing, okay? Hope is, it's very easy to confuse hope with expectation.
Mm.
The movie Shawshank Redemption has a wonderful, exquisite scene between Tim Robbins, who plays a character by the name of Andy Dufresne,
mm-hmm.
and Red is played by Morgan Freeman,
mm-hmm.
and Red tells Andy, in no uncertain terms, that in prison, hope is a dangerous thing. Hope will take you into the darkest depths of hell. Just give up. And what he means, of course, is hope as expectation, uh-huh. and specifically expectation of parole.
Uh-huh.
And if you live in terms of, I'm going to be paroled next January, and if it doesn't happen, you just get pounded
mm-hmm.
lower and lower. So let me in response to your question, because time is flying here, okay? it is an orientation of the spirit. It's a directionality. It's not the conviction that something will turn out well, but it's the certainty that something makes sense,
mm-hmm.
regardless of how things turn out in the short haul. So you can imagine that individuals, for example, who work on civil rights or who work for the liberation of, and the for a specific large kind of social goal, they're going to have to let go of kind of those immediate kind of benchmarks of success,
mm-hmm.
and commit themselves to a direction because they believe in the integrity and the correctness of the direction.
Mm.
For us, of course, that's the gospel.
Yeah.
That's the gospel.
Yes.
Okay?
Yes.
And it's trusting in a divine creator who loves this world, who doesn't create it for futility, who sends the word made flesh into the world to redeem it, and the spirit moving with us and through the creation. So we're part of that triune mystery, mm-hmm. but it's oriented in that direction.
Hmm.
That may have felt like I just opened up a fire hose in response to your question. Okay, you just wanted a drink of water.
No.
I hope it makes sense.
It does.
Okay.
It does, and I'd like to hear what you would say about, you know, where you personally find that kind of hope. You've mentioned in the Gospels, I would imagine in your community. Where else do you, Abbot John, find it?
I definitely, for myself, and this is something, this is the gift of the life I live. The the discipline of the monastic schedule. Okay, but we all have schedules. So monks aren't the only one who have schedules.
Right.
We all have a day that unfolds. But our day is marked, punctuated by prayer throughout the day as a community. And of course, the meat and potatoes of that prayer are the Psalms themselves.
Mm-hmm.
The Psalms are filled with hope. I would say there are 25 Psalms that explicitly use the word hope. And that's because many of them are laments. I mean, when things are not going well, either for individuals or the community, there's a lament, but there will always be, except in one Psalm, Psalm 88, an expression of compelling hope. And that is that awareness of the God who brought Israel out of the land of Egypt, that place of slavery, that God is still working and present in Israel. And it always will come back to that fundamental conviction. And sometimes you'll hear these incredible Psalm 44, Lord, how long? You know, wake up. Back it off, huh?
Right.
You know, you've got to be with us. This is not a time to be quiet. Such powerful. And, you know, of course, when we pray them in community, some of that intensity is dampered simply because we pray them and go on. But if you are praying them as an individual, I mean, those Psalms will stop you in your tracks.
Yeah, I was praying one in my morning prayer just a few days ago, and it's this psalm that, you know, you have left me without friend or family. You have cast me into the darkness.
Psalm 88.
Oh, is it? Okay.
That's 88. Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, a second practice. So let me back up and just say, I mean, I think that what we can do is be too concerned about getting through a number of psalms rather than letting our own resonance with what's going on in a psalm really help us unpack what's going on inside. A second practice.
Just to stay with a psalm for a week or two days
or whatever.
Yeah.
And unpack it and write about it and write out of it and write your own psalm. Okay.
Yeah.
Lectio for me is that practice, which is so simple, simply picking up a text, reading it very slowly, sitting with it, dwelling on the words that are popping or making sense or phrases. And then reading, and I always read them out loud.
Mm-hmm.
So I want to hear the text. And for me, journaling these past months has just been extremely important, because what I find myself doing is registering what's going on in my interaction with the text. Okay.
Wow. So these practices that you're talking about, Lectio and sitting with the Psalms, this is speaking to that second part of your title, a hope rooted in Benedictine practices. Right. Yeah. Are there others that are important to you personally?
I think, for me, over the years, a wonderful Anglican or Episcopalian in this country, priest, Cynthia Bergeau.
Yeah.
Written a fantastically wonderful book, Centering Prayer and Inner Awakening. And for me, when there are, you know, in my own language, too many words, to simply be in silence and to sit in silence and simply let go of my agenda, my concerns, my worries, which can be very, very hard. But it's a way also to kind of do some self-monitoring and stuff. You know, what's going on in my headspace? That is as weird as it, you know, when you stop talking and you stop listening and you simply want to sit in silence, where does my mind automatically go?
And it goes. Yeah.
I mean, you know, whatever I'm concerned about or whatever I'm worried about or whatever I'm really ticked off about. So it's a way to really become aware of that and make a decision to let go of it.
Wow.
To not be, you know, have that cranking away in my head in the background, background noise with what I'm doing. Okay.
Wow.
So.
Are there changes that you've encountered during the pandemic? On a personal basis, on a community basis, you know, the sisters here at St. Scholastica we've had to stop all our programming. It's all being done on Zoom. And how is your community functioning with the pandemic?
Yeah, so fundamentally, of course, we had to reinvent liturgy.
Yeah.
By spacing people out, by simplifying the way we move people around in terms of soloists. We had to really be concerned about singing. And ultimately, on June 1, we made the decision to simply wear masks all the time at liturgy. We had to simplify our Eucharistic expression to simply use consecrated hosts, except for the celebrant. So extremely simple. For a while, it just hurt. Mm. We fundamentally had to lock the outside community out.
Yeah.
So that is our chaplains, our pastors, our faculty residents in the dorms. That is, they really could not be with us in the monastery or in our dining room.
So just to clarify, you're talking about monks who serve in other positions on the campus could not come and be with the main body of that. Wow.
Tough. Okay. This was brutal. We were finally able in June. We started dining Tuesdays, every Tuesday evening. We rediscovered our backyard. Because it was the outside, we could use tables, distancing, etc., and we could spread out under those two big silver maple trees and dine together on Tuesday nights. We also reinvented the way we do community meetings using Zoom a lot, so we could include our monks in St. Raphael Hall, as well as those who wanted to Zoom in, and then those who were in a physical space together. In early August, we went to a green group and a blue group.
A green what?
Group and a blue group. And the green group is less involved with the outside. And so they sit in one part of our dining room and the blue group sits in the other side, okay? And our choir stalls as well, simply because the blue group is having, so we could re-invite our pastors, our chaplains, our faculty residents back into the dining room. We spread out even more. We split up. We run a double shift at our midday meal. So long story short, we had to really figure it out how we could do the science really, really well in terms of distancing, in terms of what we do with, in terms of masks in the house, where we are at prayer, and yet at the same time, again, be more of one community.
So would you say that all those changes that have happened like that and the struggles that you've gone through to keep the community connected in that way, what kind of new awarenesses have come from it?
So I think we just really, as everybody has, I think, become aware of how much we depend on physical touch, on a touching people on an arm, a shoulder, of being close, of what it means to read each other's, the expression on somebody's face.
Yeah.
And in terms of sadness, disbelief, tiredness, you name it, joy, disappointment, that whole field of emotions from A to Z, and our ability to support each other as well. So, you know, we haven't had any staff meetings in person since mid-March. Yeah. Everything is on Zoom.
Yeah.
And frankly, we just need to do that, because if we had a spreader event at a staff meeting, you know, my goodness gracious, huh? So yeah, we've learned that. The positive discovery is we discovered the backyard.
Isn't that wonderful?
It is.
I think many, many of us have rediscovered the joy of being outside. Even in the winter.
Even in the winter, yeah. This summer, I did more biking than I've ever done.
Yeah.
I put on between 500 and 600 miles on the Wobegon Trail.
Wow.
Yeah, and it was magnificent. It really was. Yeah,
it was very sustaining for me to be outside and just walking through the summer. And I know several people have told me I have never spent so much time outside in my life.
Yeah.
So there's something very beautiful about that awareness too, and our connection spiritually, physically to the environment, to nature. And then so interesting too, some of the discoveries that have been made about the environment as we've all been staying home more and using fewer resources. It's been rather, rather astonishing. And I don't know, as a scientist, maybe you want to comment on that a little.
Oh, well, I mean, I think the environmental scientists are having a field day looking at the precise kind of changes, for example, in the air quality in major cities, simply because of the reduction in traffic. And what's happening in terms of carbon dioxide levels and other gases in the air and the environment. On the other hand, the parks, our state and national parks have just been overwhelmed by the number of people who have come. And many of them, shall we say, not experienced campers.
Right. That's very kind. Yes. Yes, I've been in a state park right on the edge of Duluth that it was difficult to keep distance from people even. And
is that Gooseberry Falls?
No, it was.
Oh, it was one of the other ones. Okay, but anyway. There's so many people there. You have a hard time distance.
Yeah, keeping away. In these Benedictine conversations, so we talk a lot, or I like to talk with the guests a lot about particular Benedictine values that are important to them, that are important in our world today. And I just wonder if you have any thoughts about that, Abbot John. Is there a particular Benedictine value that seems very, very pertinent for what we're going through now with a pandemic, racial unrest, you know, climate catastrophes, et cetera, divisive systems. And so what would you say to that?
For myself, these past months, reading scripture, but right next to it, reading the newspaper, reading the New Yorker magazine, reading Atlantic, just sitting and being in quiet and trying to make sense of the connections, trying to put things together, and then, and just forcing myself to write, was a way to move thoughts out of my head, toward synthesis and some kind of comprehension and testing the integrity of my understanding. And also just seeing and saying, okay, so where is God in all of this?
Yeah.
Where is the liberation? Where is the work of the Spirit? As painful and hard as, you know, some of the things were this summer, and seeing the explosion of violence, and as well as real sustained nonviolent protest in the wake of George Floyd's murder in Minneapolis. A lot of things came together, and of course, what they did was they pushed me to go and say, okay, there are things I don't know here that I should know, and pushed me to read deeper in other directions as well. Mm-hmm. So, okay. But that would be, I mean, and that kind of reflective listening and mindfulness, attentiveness to what's going on in the world and what's going on in the scriptures and oneself, is core to Benedictine spirituality.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, I'll ask you more about that in just a minute, but I want to let people know that this is the time where if you have a comment or a question for Abbot John, if you would send it in either by chat or if you want to raise your hand, I can give you permission to talk, and we'll see what kind of questions come in for the abbot. So please send them in. We'll try to get to what we can. So as people are formulating questions, Abbot John, one thing that I would just like to ask you about what you just said, you know, trying to make sense of where God is in this, where the Spirit is moving. Are there particular places that you've really seen that happening?
Okay. I was particularly grabbed by the sheer cry of pain. Okay. Of people hurting.
Yeah.
And as you know, the church has, and the society, the whole culture, has just come through 30, 40 years of trying to come to terms with the sexual abuse of children.
Yeah.
Becoming aware of that pain in young people, but the way it's played itself out in adults, and just trying to understand that pain people within our church and within the larger culture. A few years ago, 4 years ago, we had all of a sudden this explosion of awareness in the Me Too movement.
Yeah, yeah.
On the part of women.
Yeah.
And men turning to their wives or to women friends and saying, did this happen to you? And of course, the answer would be invariably, well, yeah. And just an awareness of oh my goodness gracious, what has been hidden here for the Black and Latino community and other people of color, our Native American people.
Yeah.
My goodness gracious. Again, to be aware, almost as if we're right back in 1967 and 68 and 69. That is the sheer pain that is present in these communities. And we just have to say, wow, we just have to become aware on a fundamentally new level as to what's going on in our country and what are the way our social systems and dynamics and economies are just chewing people up.
Yeah. A couple of weeks ago.
That's a long, long response.
No, that's fine. No, I'm right there with you, as I'm sure so many people are. A couple of weeks ago, I had the privilege of being on a webinar that the subject matter was the boarding school healing from Indigenous peoples that had experienced it and the legacy of it and so forth. And you know, I came out, it was very heavy, but I came out of that feeling hope, you know, just to hear them speak about the power and the healing that was coming to them from speaking their story. And I experienced the same thing this summer too. Yeah. We do have a question from Heather. She says, can you tell us more about how you are able to let go of worries that may be weighing on your mind? How do we let go of something, especially if that thing is something we need to eventually face or deal with, like a family concern, problem at work, etc.? How do we let go?
Great question.
Yeah.
For me, it's always a matter of, and I'm sure you do this too, and that is trying to sort out, okay, what are the concerns? Because usually there's more than one.
Sure.
And secondly, there's usually a set of things over which I have some kind of ability to respond, okay? And there are other things that, hey, all bets are off.
Yeah. Okay?
I don't have control.
Yeah.
So one of the great liberations for me was, as Abbot was, when I was first Abbot, it never failed. 4 o'clock on a Friday afternoon, some doggone thing would come flying in over the transom, and I'd be just like, oh my goodness, what am I going to do? Okay. And it would scare me half to death. Okay. And this began to frustrate me very quickly, because I thought, wait a minute, I can't go through the next X number of years worrying about what's going to come in over the transom. Mm-hmm. I have to stand in a different relationship to this. Mm-hmm. And the liberation came for me to say, okay, wait a minute, I don't have to deal with this alone.
Ah.
Who do I need to ask? Who do I need to share this problem with? Who do I need to have around the table? What kinds of help do I need? And that was a question to live with. It was liberating, because I wasn't pretending that somehow I was going to have all the answers or the solutions, etc. Mm-hmm. But that I needed to bring others in. That mm-hmm. there were times when I was going to have to do really hard things and really hard conversations, but we can do those when we know that they're the right conversation.
Yeah, yeah. Speak the truth and deal with the fallout.
Yeah, yeah. And it's not about me. And,
right.
You know, am I going to get hurt in this? Most likely.
I'm also reminded in a prior conversation I had with you, and we were talking about the psalmists. You said something that really intrigued me. You said the psalmists, you know, in these psalms of lament, they'd yell out their lament to God, and then they would leave it.
Yeah. They were not afraid to get really angry with God and frustrated. And but if you look at those psalms, just in that expression, there is a release.
Yeah, yeah.
There's a release. And there will also be an expression of hope.
Yeah, yeah. We have another question from Stacy. Thank you for your question, Heather. The question from Stacy, she says, thank you, Abbot Klassen and Dawn. With the importance of listening within the Benedictine tradition, what new ways have you approached listening within this pandemic year?
Great, great question.
Yeah.
Like Heather's, okay? For myself, one of the things that I was doing was I was out in nature more. And mm-hmm. what I made sure was that I never had my ears covered.
Oh.
I was listening deliberately and intentionally, listening to nature, to the wind, to the waves, to birds, to squirrels,
yeah.
Scampering up trees. Secondly, I've really grown in my love for listening to just really powerful choral music. And of course, Minnesota Public Radio has, Minnesota is the, I mean, if you want to go someplace for choral music, where do you go? Minnesota.
Absolutely. The choral stream. Yes.
It is. And NPR has just amazing choral music on it. And it's some of it's religious, some of it's not, but it's just so powerful. And what it does is, for me, Heather's question, how do you get rid of worries? One way to do it is to let a beautiful piece of choral music just simply blow it right out of there.
Huh. So just to let it wash, it's just
yeah. Take it away.
Which is a different kind of, that's a different kind of listening. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Interesting. Thank you for your question, Stacy.
Yes. Yeah.
I'm curious, please send in questions. We've got time and room for more. If you've got anything at all you'd like to ask the abbot, it doesn't even have to pertain to this particular talk on hope. But as we move through these dark days of winter, you know, and I think fall is sometimes tough for a lot of people with the changing of the seasons and the shortening of the days. And I know this year there was such a dread within me, like, oh my gosh, here we go. Winter's coming, the pandemic. It felt kind of suffocating, right?
Sure.
And so I've turned to self-care. And kind of reframing how I think about it. And I'm just wondering what you do for self-care,
yeah.
for self-nourishment.
Yes, that's a great, great question. Great question. So one of the first things I learned back, so when I was active and engaged in teaching, et cetera, my weight was pretty stable. I was up and around. I was running for the bus, going to St. Ben's, on my feet in the lab all day. And then I was elected abbot. And all of a sudden, you know, the trousers that I was wearing were wearing out in the back rather than in the front. Huh? and I'm eating good meals at board meetings and having a glass of wine or two. And my weight just went like,
wow. I mean,
in 2 years, it went right up. It went up 20 pounds.
Oh my goodness.
And I'm sitting there saying, wow, this, I know I can draw straight lines. I really can. I know where this ends up. But the other thing is that the stress was killing me.
Yeah.
There was no, so long story short, a program of exercise that's appropriate for you. For me, that was pretty vigorous work on an elliptical, alternating with good strength work. We brought in, we had a trainer we brought into the community once a month.
Oh.
Who would meet with a group of us and show us how to use, do weight work in a way that made sense and wouldn't hurt us. And it's just made all the difference in the world.
Wow. Okay?
So good physical care is absolutely crucial, I think.
Wow.
Secondly, for me, building and getting Lexio to be a part of my everyday life, no matter what happened in the rest of the day, getting it done early in the morning, really, 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 really important for me. Over the years, just, and especially in this time, I really looked at books on, particularly on racism, on the whole issue of caste by Isabel Wilkerson. But I tend to balance that out with something in science and theology. So a good book called Big Bang by, I think it's Walter Singh. A great book on habits that I found this past year by James Clear, Atomic Habits.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
I gotta write that one down.
The idea is so one person wanted to go and start exercise, couldn't do it, said he would just drive to the outside of the exercise place and he would just look at it. He did a few days. And maybe on the third day, he actually went in. Didn't do anything, but went in, okay? And the whole idea is to keep lowering the energy barrier till it's so small that you keep doing it.
Okay. Well, you know,
fun book.
And it sounds like it. And I think it pertains to a question that just came in.
Okay.
I think it does, but she says, have you ever had times, first she says, I've really enjoyed listening to this. Thank you for your wisdom. This is Heather. And she says, have you ever had times when it's just harder to feel spiritual peace, even when you're studying scriptures or praying? I just noticed that there are times when no matter what I do, I just emotionally feel more numb or my mind is distracted. I'm struggling to connect with God in that particular moment. What do you do when you have those moments?
I do have them. I think that they are part of the web, simply the web of stuff that you, Heather, and all of us feel in our lives at different times. I think for me, my gut instinct in those is to move from the verbal to simply sit in silence.
Yeah, showing up. Yeah.
Centering prayer and just be in silence.
Yeah.
And let God, you know, as Cynthia Bergeau says simply, give God permission to work on me.
Hmm.
Okay.
Rather than me.
Yeah, yeah. Giving up any pretense or like somehow I'm going to jerry-rig this. Huh?
Yep. Yeah.
But anyway, I think for me, wow, that can be a very, and of course, when I try to do that at first, it's just chaotic stuff flying around, etc. And the first impulse is to say, God, my God, I'm never going to do that again. Okay. And to stay with it
and
choose a sacred word, believe it or not, I'm not making this up, my word is hope.
Mm.
Okay?
Wow.
It's one syllable. Yeah. Anything more confuses my mind. Okay?
Okay. It's a word that's quite packed, though. Yes.
Yeah. But it just in silence.
Yeah.
Sometimes I really want to do it for 20. But I've learned over the years, if I can only do it for 10, I'll do it for 10.
Wow.
And it works.
Wonderful. Thank you for your question, Heather. That's a really important question. We have a question here from Amy. She says, what do you see as a role for the church and Benedictines in politics?
The church and right now, extreme polarization.
Yeah.
Okay. And the gift I think that we can give from within the church and from within the Benedictine environment is to cultivate actively our skills for being in and staying in conversations that are very tense.
Yeah.
And asking the kind of flat-footed questions that build trust.
Hmm.
Such as asking someone how they understand a particular situation or event, and where their emotions are on it, and what gives them reasons to be distrustful,
mm-hmm.
and do they have any reasons for being hopeful?
Yeah.
If their explanation for or understanding of something, do they have any areas that give them pause where they're not sure that they're doing justice to the complexity of the situation?
Yeah. Okay.
So in other words, really unpacking it and finding out, but the main thing is respect.
Mm.
I don't know where I stole this line from, but respect is like air. If you take it away, it's all everybody can think about.
Wow. Yeah, that's a good one. I wonder, Kevin Vaughn, who is the director of the Catholic Studies program over at St. Scholastica, has this question, and I wonder if it ties into what you just said. He says, thank you for your reflections this evening. My question is, what do you think is the greatest challenge facing the church moving forward after this pandemic?
Okay, greatest challenge. I think it is the church is going to have to use everything it's learned and understand what good pastoral care is, and it's going to have to reach out to the communities that are part of respective parishes and invite people back to church.
Hmm.
Okay.
Wow.
That's number one. Okay. That is right now we just have, you know, people are just genuinely afraid of coming to church. They just don't want to get COVID-19. But within that, there's a gift there. And that is if you learn to invite people back who were already coming to church,
mm.
you might actually learn something about inviting people who stopped coming to church.
Yeah.
In terms
before
of asking
the pandemic.
Before the pandemic.
Yeah, that's a good
simply,
point.
Who simply were absenting themselves from the community of believers for reasons we could write out on the back of an envelope. Huh? We've read the surveys, you know, we've chewed up the data. Okay. Now what do we do? you know.
Yeah.
And the third thing is the church has to attend in a fundamental way to questions of justice within the church itself.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, I'm conscious that we're at our time. There's a couple of questions that we didn't get to that I will try to reach out to these people and see what I can do. I just want to thank everyone for being here tonight. This has been a wonderful conversation. Great questions coming in on our chat. And to invite you all to our next Benedictine conversation, which is going to be on January 12th. And our guest that evening will be Carl Crawford, who is the Human Rights Commissioner for the City of Duluth. And we'll be speaking about race and justice and so forth. The registration link will be coming out probably next week. I also want to remind anyone who missed one of our first three or Benedictine conversations, or if you want to look at this one again, that we do have an archive page, and that will come in the next invitation to Benedictine Conversations. There's a little link at the bottom if you can't find it by going to our website. So I just want to thank you, Abbot John, for being here. And this has been just lovely. Thank you for your time and
for your
thoughtful reflections and for your gift of some new insights into that virtue of hope. I really thank you for that during this Advent season. So what kind of words would you leave us with?
What kind of words would I leave you with? If you want to watch a great movie on hope, watch A Man Called Ove.
Ove?
Ove, O-V-E.
O-V-E.
It's a story in some, it's Swedish movie, English subtitles, about a man who has suffered one incredible loss after another. And his own discovery of hope. Okay.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you for that. And to all our participants, and to you, Abbot John, and the wonderful St. John's community, from the Sisters of St. Scholastica and the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment, we say to all of you out there with us tonight, blessings of peace and joy to you and your families as we welcome the light of Christ into our midst. Thank you. And God bless you all.
Peace.